Zib, shouldn't you be up on stage playing?
For who?
That guy?
Hello and welcome, everybody. I'm your host, Captain Rutledge. You may remember me from such YouTube series as This Is Public Broadcasting, Sharp's Cannon, and Behind the Railway series. Let's face it, my interests are many. And with the wonderful gift of YouTube, I'm able to share my passions with all of you. And recently, I've gained a new interest. It has cats, organized crime, and some pretty hot jazz. You read the video title, so you should probably know what I'm talking about.
Lackadaisy originally started out as a series of webcomics created by Tracy J. Butler in 2006. Over the years, more comics were written and illustrated, the fan base grew, and an animated film went into production, premiering in 2023. Today, an animated series is in production, funded through fans old and new, and due to premiere later on this year.
After watching the pilot animated film and reading through all of the comics, I became obsessed. I studied all I could about the characters, the background, everything. I put it all onto that foremost of internet culture organizational tools, the Iceberg chart. La. And now, I'd like to go through the chart with you all today. Yes, yes, I know Iceberg chart videos are horrendously unfashionable now, but when was the last time I was accused of being fashionable? So, sit down, grab yourself an illicit beverage or stack of pancakes, and take a journey with me through the official, unofficial Lackadaisy Iceberg. Now, before we begin, I'd better get the costumes lined up. Very fetching, I must say. Should add the sepia tinting real quick. Let's go.
For those of you unaware, an iceberg chart is an organizational tool where at the top, the surface level, things that are well known are discussed, but as you move further down, you get into more obscure, dark, and sometimes disturbing facets. And without further ado, we shall start with the top layer. So, Tracy J. Butler, the creator of the Lackadaisy comics. She was born in Springfield, Massachusetts, and moved to St. Louis, Missouri to work for video game developers Simutronics. Her love for art, swing music, and history got her interested in local prohibition history in St. Louis, eventually creating the Lackadaisy comics in 2006. Freckle and Ivy. In the short film and comics, Freckle and Ivy show a romantic interest in each other. More so on Ivy's end than Freckle's. Freckle is more shy and reserved, while Ivy is more outgoing and open, making the best adorable couple you could find on the internet.
Come on, you owe me a dance!
I do?
Yes, I decided.
After completing the animated pilot, the team behind the pilot released a number of short episodes on YouTube. The first two, Breakthrough and Stratagem, were both under 2 minutes. The third, Ingenue, went for full 5 minutes. All three occurred before the events of the main comic, but they still show our favorite characters and how they got to where they are today.
You've dislocated both of your arms in the spirit of discovery!
St. Louis serves as a setting for the comics and cartoon. Located between the Mississippi and Missouri rivers, it's a popular hub for rail and river transport, and it's riddled with limestone caverns where speakeasies and hooch cellars were hidden, much like the Lackadaisy Club in the comics.
It may seem pretty avant-garde to have a bootlegger series not set in either New York or Chicago, but it's just a reminder that Prohibition was nationwide and everybody was breaking it nationwide. Like, there's still a couple bars in my hometown that still have their hooch hidey holes. And there was that one time that Grandma tried making dandelion wine. That was a Memorial Day to never forget. where were we?
Alongside the animated pilot, a number of animation loops were released on the Lackadaisy YouTube channel. These include a loop of Ivy doing the Charleston, some rubber hose-styled characters playing music from the show, Ivy and Freckle dancing together, and Mordecai and Victor just sitting and playing chess. All of which include great music and a little ASMR. Liquid Gold is a single by Paranoid DJ, featuring vocals by Michael Kovach, Belshazzar Rusape, and Lisa Reimold. It was released on August 5th, 2023, 4 months after the original short film premiere, with visuals based off the original short pencil tests and some of the comic strips. On the subject of music, the soundtrack for the Lackadaisy short film consists largely of electric-style swing music. The composition Olive Branch was composed by Portland, Oregon electric swing band Sepia Tonic, and Sunset Rose Cocktail was composed by the Louisville-based musician M. Gewehr, while the tune Feathers and Fringe, used in the credits, was created by Albert Marlowe.
Encore? No encore?
A Sunset Rose Cocktail is a name given by Victor to the watered-down coffin varnish masquerading as whiskey in the animated pilot. Let's just say that when you criminalize alcohol production, you also tend to throw out regulations on production, so almost anything could be sold as liquor, from formaldehyde to methyl alcohol, not to mention the stuff that was cut by the federal government with some very questionable poisons. Yeah, look that up.
Well, it'll certainly start your engine.
But let's say that you are over the age of 21 and interested in making a Sunset Rose cocktail for yourself. Now, there is a cocktail out there called a Sunset Rose, but it's made using vodka and rosé, both of which weren't widely available in America during the 1920s. Instead, I sort of crafted my own little recipe, variation off of a classic whiskey cocktail. First up, you gotta start with a good quality Canadian whiskey. The short used old log cabin whiskey, but if you can't find that, just use a nice oak-aged Canadian rye. And you will also need sugar, lemon juice, lemon peel, Angostura bitters, and grenadine, and ice. So, first up, with your jigger ready, and your cocktail shaker. Let's start out with about 2 ounces worth of your whiskey of choice. Now, next up, add in a couple dashes of your bitters, a smidge of grenadine, or however much you want to taste. 1 cube of sugar, and well, let's say about a tablespoon of lemon juice. Now just add in your ice, put the top on the shaker, and shake well. Sorry to you folks with headphones out there. Once it's well shaken, rub the rim of your glass with the lemon peel. Twist it together for the garnish. And pouring your drink straight up. Ideally, you should use a smaller glass than this. And that, my fine folks, is a Sunset Rose Cocktail by what I think it ought to be.
Sunset Rose Cocktail? That sounds good!
Now let's say you're under the age of 21. In that case, just substitute the whiskey and the sugar for your favorite type of ginger ale. So let's see how we did.
Sophisticated!
That is delicious. That's really good.
It beats radiator fluid.
I can't sit here drinking all day, so let's move on to the next layer. Oops.
Ah, well, it matters not. Feel good, look like $1 million. So, let's get on with the next layer.
Has-Been Hotel is another animated web pilot created by Vivian Medrano and currently produced by A24 and Amazon. Upon release, the Lackadaisy cartoon was compared to the original Has-Been Hotel pilot episode on YouTube, sharing some of the violence and underdog plot beats, as well as voice actor Michael Kovach lending his talents to both productions.
What's the deal with smiles over there?
The Lackadaisy series picks up shortly after the death of Atlas May, owner of the Little Daisy Cafe and Lackadaisy Speakeasy. In 1926, at the height of his success, Atlas was found mysteriously murdered, passing his business onto his widow, Mitzi May. His murderer was never found, but word on the street was that Mitzi had him rubbed out, which she somewhat denies.
So, all the talk of conspired homicide, hired guns, and you is indeed as fictional as it sounds?
Of course. I loved Atlas.
Why allow the air of mystery to linger about what happened then? The speculation echoing from the peanut gallery certainly hasn't helped your cause.
Not in the least. I just don't like to discuss it. Wasn't so long ago, you know. I suppose I could tell you about it. Someday, if you really...
You don't owe me that. I'm sorry to have even mentioned it. Duly ashamed to boot.
Access to the Lackadaisy Speakeasy was granted only to individuals hiding the club pin under their collar or lapel. These pins were shaped like the club suit on a deck of cards, and replicas were at one time available for purchase on the Lackadaisy shop.
And I gotta say, they are pretty fetching.
The Marigold Room is operated by Atlas's former ally and friend, Asa Sweet, in the Hotel Marigold. Main rivals to the Lackadaisy Speakeasy and described as highly posh. Mordecai, Nico, and Seraphine all work for Sweet and Marigold. Originally, when planning the Lackadaisy webcomic, Tracy created preliminary sketches of the characters whom we know and love today. Although their clothes are rather anachronistic and their personalities differ somewhat, they are still somewhat recognizable. We can see Rocky and Freckle, Mitzi, Ivy, Wick, Mordecai, Seraphine and Nicodeme, even Aunt Nina and Victor. Kind of jarring, though, having Rocky and Mitzi falling asleep in each other's arms in one bit of artwork. After the pilot was released, a backer kit fundraising campaign was set up to raise money for a potential series of web episodes of Lackadaisy. Originally, with a funding goal of $125,000, a single series would be made. However, the funding surpassed $2 million in its two-month campaign, allowing for new short films to be released as well. As of right now, three shorts have been released, with the first episode of the new series planning on being released sometime in 2024. ProZD is the YouTube channel of Korean-American actor Sungwon Cho. Cho has been involved with Lackadaisy since 2013, when he made fan comic dubs of a few pages giving life to the character of Mordecai Heller using a droll, no-nonsense cadence.
What becomes of your demeanor when you drink?
I don't drink. Let me tell you something about my friend Victor. Have you seen that guy? He's built like a s**t brick house. Brick hoops. I dropped my thing.
In the pilot short and upcoming series, Cho has reprised his role as Mordecai and even gave viewers some un-Mordecai-like lines during much-beloved Discord sessions.
I'll have you know, I graduated top of my class in the Navy SEALs, and I've been involved in numerous secret raids on Al-Qaeda, and I have over 300 confirmed kills.
Mordecai, ladies and gentlemen.
Sedgwick Sable had been a longtime customer of Atlas May's. While Atlas was still alive, Wick took interest in the limestone cavern of Lackadaisy, as well as meeting Mitzi for the first time. After Atlas's death, Wick became more supportive of Mitzi, even bringing his upper-crust friends to Lackadaisy for a drink just to drum up some business. Although Wick and Mitzi both are romantically interested in each other, Wick cannot fully embrace her on account of workers and investors depending on him and his business for their daily bread. He doesn't trust her that much either.
Oh, see? You can even be a little mean when you want to. What a waste of talent. Are you sure I can't convince you?
I'm still not convinced you aren't trying to kill me, Mitzi. Albeit the unconventional way.
That's it then? No deal?
Afraid so.
Well, I guess it's time to bring me home too.
Lackadaisy with Grandma is a video on the Lackadaisy YouTube channel made by the pilot sound supervisor Kennedy Phillips. He, his mother, and his grandmother, Martha Gomber, sat down and watched the pilot episode together, with Martha's reactions recorded. Sadly, Martha passed away just before the video was released, with the video dedicated in her honor.
And it was a fitting tribute to those of the silent generation, who nowadays are few and far between.
Malcolm Ray is a Chicago-based actor originally from Louisiana, who voices Nicodeme Savoy in the Lackadaisy pilot.
I think I swallowed the bug.
You got a big fat bad bed for dinner, who's fat?
Nah, just more glass.
Malcolm is likely best known for his work with Doug Walker on the Nostalgia Critic web series. During the Robin Hood episode of Nostalgia Critic, he actually mentioned his involvement with Lackadaisy in a post-credit sequence.
Hey, Lackadaisy wanted me for a reason?
Yes, I still watch Nostalgia Critic. Sue me. Oh, come on. When I said sue me, I was being sarcastic. So you can be sued for sarcasm as well. Ah, well, at least they let me keep my long johns. Note to self. Keep your big mouth shut.
Sable Stone and Quarry Company is the latest venture of St. Louis businessman Sedgwick Sable. The area around St. Louis is abundant in both limestone and lead ore, and despite the lower quality of the limestone, it is of decent enough quality to use for aggregate in road construction. And so, the Sable Stone and Quarry Company was set up between the Mississippi and Missouri to extract limestone. At least until Rocky destroys the place in the Lackadaisy pilot.
About the dynamite and machinery, can you elaborate?
Mr. Sable?
Right. Cheers.
Asa Sweet was Atlas's old friend and business rival. They started out running underground poker games until Prohibition hit, when they started dealing in contraband liquor and speakeasies. Despite competition, the two remained on good terms. After Atlas mysteriously died, Asa took over much of the bootlegging operation from Atlas's widow Mitzi, and is currently St. Louis's top crime boss during the comic storyline. It's also hinted that he knows something about Atlas's murder.
Speculation perhaps? Eyebrows raised? Okay, I'll stop playing with my eyebrows. And we can move on to the next layer. Well, this is very schoolboyish. I guess I'm dressed as Freckle right now. Speaking of which, I wonder... Let's continue.
The Arbogasts live outside St. Louis in a funeral parlor in Defiance, Missouri. Abelard is a minister, as Tracy puts it, straight out of the Great Awakening. His sister Elsa is a world-weary former nurse. Elsa's husband, Bobby Bastian, operates the funeral parlor. The three of them were former associates of Atlas May, helping transfer liquor to Lackadaisy, but after Atlas's death, they found themselves supplying for Asa Sweet instead.
Give me the gun. Give it to me. Because in that sea there's no surface, no chance of unburdening breath, no vindicating sun. And every stumble and misdeed made thereafter in that bitter deep is another hot iron ring about your neck to speed your descent into the boiling black pit.
No, no!
like a giant spider. Don't do that.
But Hellfire?
The Lackadaisy forums once existed on the Little Daisy Cafe website prior to 2020, where fans could discuss artwork, stories, or send questions to Tracy Butler. It has since been removed from the website, and now most of the forum operations have migrated to the Lackadaisy Discord server and Tumblr page.
I tried Discord once. It did not end well.
The characters in the series all use firearms based off real-life examples. Apart from the 45 caliber Thompson submachine gun, Mitzi May wields a Beretta 1919 handgun.
It's nice and light, in a lady's handbag. No stopping power.
Mordecai uses a Colt M1911 semi-automatic, and Seraphine has a custom Browning automatic rifle, which she nicknames Boudreaux. Rocky himself used to have a Colt semi-automatic, at least until he shot a hole in his ear. In early Rough Draft comics, we learn how Rocky's cousin Calvin inherited his nickname of Freckle. While the two were young, Rocky shaved the fur off of Calvin's face, revealing just one solitary freckle and a nickname for life. Not that Freckle minds all that much. I, for one, would also prefer a dorky nickname over the name of... Coolidge.
Tank the U.S. economy, will ya?
Many of the characters in the Lackadaisy series were inspired by cats Tracy Butler either owned or knew. Ivy and Freckle were based off Tracy's pet cats Ivy and Calvin. Sadly, both Ivy and Calvin have both passed away. Rocky was also based off another former cat, while Zib was based off a cat Tracy's mother owned.
On a personal note, these cats remind me of my family's cats growing up. Old Lucky. He was with us for a long, long time. He lived in the barn, caught mice, and he stood outside the grill waiting for his portion of steak whenever we had a barbecue. And then there was the times he would tear apart the rabbits and leave us a little Lucky rabbit's foot. By the time he passed away, he had just one working eye and a torn ear. He was a good cat. Unlike his replacement, Miss Rocky, aka Fluff, Fluffers, Fluffer Nuts, HR Fluff and Stuff, you get it. You know, she was a female cat, but honestly, she behaved more like a female dog, if you get my meaning. And today, the farm is kept rodent-free by Miss Freddy and Little Deborah. Two more wonderful cats. But enough about my mushiness, where were we?
Wes and Fish are two of Ace's subordinates who keep a lookout on the liquor trade around Defiance. Wes Parker looks more like a weasel than a cat, while Fish, his partner, has a broken nose inflicted by Wes himself for some past stupidity.
Hey, you hear about that new Lon Chaney picture where he's got feet for hands because he's got no arms? And he throws knives with his feet because he's in a circus and... You embarrass me like that again, Fish, and you'll have to join the circus. The guy who tells jokes with his feet because someone punched his face in. That'd be funny, ha!
They twice run in with our heroes in the comic. Their second encounter nearly results with them getting their shins shot off by Freckle.
How much longer are we gonna be stuck out here?
I don't know. You think I'd be stuck out here with you? If the echelons had told me anything?
My girl's really upset I can't take her out weekend nights. She's gonna dust off when she sees my face.
Yeah? Let's hear more about the mystery girl who likes you for your face.
She settled for my face. Now it's worse. At least it's not a weasel face.
That's brazen.
I was trying to mumble it under my breath, but I can't breathe right.
Ivy's father, Reuben Pepper, was an old school friend of Atlas May's, and the two were so close that Atlas became Ivy's godfather after her birth. When Prohibition fell in place, Ruby assisted Atlas's bootlegging operation from Kansas City, coming to St. Louis occasionally to discuss business. A few times, he would bring Ivy along with him, and she would often be treated like royalty at the Little Daisy Cafe, gradually learning about the true nature of her father's involvement. After Atlas died, though, Ruby ceased visiting St. Louis and stepped back from the bootlegging trade, instead spending time with his wife Effie and younger children, a son and daughter. Rocky's favorite dish is pancakes with maple syrup and coffee with maple syrup. It's less about the pancakes themselves, rather the syrup that goes on them. Ever since he was a child, he has been one for Dada-inspired breakfast pastry, but he'll still go for waffles as well. Or anything else with syrup on it.
I've decided to try the waffles. I've returned with a hunger for new experiences. I guess, in a way, you win. You sure you don't?
I myself can't blame him, because I, too, have somewhat of a soft spot for pancakes with maple syrup. Fresh from Vermont. Although, I do often wonder what everybody else at Lackadaisy likes to eat.
According to Tracy, Freckle is a lover of sandwiches and chocolate milk. Just so long as Mrs. Babka isn't the one making the sandwich. Ivy enjoys petit fours and champagne punch. She claims to like other alcoholic cocktails, but really isn't too much of a big drinker. Mitzi has a soft spot for chocolates, and her drink of choice is the mint julep. Victor is a meat lover and misses the Slavic dishes of his youth, but isn't too picky himself. Mordecai, meanwhile, prefers cooking his own meals with easily identifiable kosher-certified ingredients, and drinks Earl Grey tea, steeped for 4 minutes exactly, and not a second longer. Both Nico and Seraphine love Cajun cooking, but it needs to be spicy enough to cause severe internal hemorrhaging. Wick himself isn't shy of a nice porterhouse steak followed by a dessert wine or apricot brandy. Asa Sweet, much like his name, has a real sweet tooth for candies, as well as very sweet cocktails. And as for Zib, years of smoking have made everything he eats taste like cigarettes. But he does have a soft spot for Italian food.
That makes me wonder about his attitude towards that one dish St. Louis has introduced to the world of Italian-American cuisine. Toasted ravioli.
1920s-era brand-name products often pop up throughout the Lackadaisy series. In Luncheon, a waitress offers up a pitcher of Bevo for Ace's table. Bevo was a non-alcoholic near beer manufactured by Anheuser-Busch during Prohibition. Originally made for the U.S. Army in World War I, essentially kept Anheuser going until the repeal of Prohibition. In Vaudevillian, Asa keeps a jar of Nut Zippers on his desk, a popular peanut caramel candy during the time, but sadly they ceased production in 2018. The publications McClure's, Saturday Evening Post, Vogue, and Vanity Fair are often mentioned too, not to mention other short glimpses of period candies in the Defiance General Store. Defiance, Missouri is an unincorporated community west of St. Louis along the Missouri River. In the comic, it is the hometown of the Arbogast and has both the Arbogast Funeral Parlor and Defiance General Store. In the old days, when Lackadaisy was in its heyday, Atlas's connections in Kansas City would load eastbound trains with quality liquor hidden away in funeral caskets. When the train stopped in Defiance before reaching St. Louis, the caskets full of liquor were unloaded and stored near the Arbogast Funeral Parlor. Then the goods would be taken to Lackadaisy in St. Louis. After Atlas's death, though, the bootlegging operation transferred to Asa Sweet and Marigold. In some non-canon artwork, Tracy has depicted our feline heroes in human form. Much like in Art Spiegelman's Mouse, the portrayal of characters as cats is more of an artistic license. They are all normal people, just portrayed as cats. Except for Rocky, there's nothing normal about him. The character page on the Lackadaisy website includes special posters for each character listed. A number of the posters are inspired by Art Deco and pulp art of the time, with a few taking inspiration from Norman Rockwell, movie stars like the Marx Brothers and Charlie Chaplin, and, in Victor's case, populist-inspired art. Throughout the comic, a few real-life locations work their way into the artwork. For example, the bridge seen in the Dithyram comic is based off the Eads Bridge across the Mississippi River. Freckle's house is based off the house where Tracy Butler lived. Mitzi meets Asa for lunch at the Bevo Mill Restaurant, a St. Louis staple. The campus where Ivy goes to school is loosely based off St. Louis University. And Wick and Mitzi have their rendezvous in Forest Park. The Marable Hotel is loosely based off the Chase Hotel. And while no street address is pinpointed, the neighborhood around the Little Daisy Cafe is inspired by Lackadaisy's Landing. It appears that any boy Ivy has interest in ends up being partially maimed in strange accidents or traumatized by the sight of her. The rhubarb comic reveals that Victor may have had something to do with their dispositions. In Victor's words, her friend Chad was bad. Claude was flawed. And Cecil was no good.
Yeah, nothing really rhymes with Cecil. Except for Cecil, you know. Nestle, wrestle, vessel with the pestle. But I'm getting too far ahead. I think it's time we moved on to the next layer. Right. Let's continue.
Elijah Metzger is a pseudonym used by Mordecai, the surname coming from the German word for butcher. It can be seen in scrapbook on a wanted poster. Also on the poster, we learn that Mordecai was responsible for the murder of two St. Louis police officers and is considered armed and dangerous. During the animated series BackerKit campaign, a pledge level existed where if a person donated a staggering amount of cash, they would have a caricature of themselves added to the animated series.
If I only could have donated that much. But let's face it, I had to pawn off my car radio just to get my clothes back after those last court cases.
On a related note, notice Ivy's friend in academia. Does her hairstyle not, remind you of somebody?
I think these bubblegum cigarettes are getting to me.
The Lackadaisy comic contains quite a body count, all things considered. In addition to Atlas May, three of the pig farmers are gunned down by Freckle, one pig farmer is presumably killed by Victor, the Arbogast organist was killed by robbers, about 14 robbers were killed by Victor and Mordecai during a flashback, and three bootleggers killed by the Savoys in Volume 3, not to mention the poor guy hacked up by Mordecai in the Hatchet Man comic.
In total, that's 23, give or take a couple here or there, or somewhere.
Dr. Leo Quackenbush is a horse doctor in St. Louis County who does odd medical duties for local gangs, provided the cash is right. He has twice given medical attention to Victor, at one point nearly having his arms ripped off. The character of Dr. Quackenbush is a blatant ripoff, in Tracy's words, of Groucho Marx's character Hugo Z. Hackenbush from A Day at the Races, right down to the thick eyebrows, glasses, and mustache. Not to mention both being horse doctors masquerading as human physicians.
She looks as healthy as any woman I've ever met.
You don't look as though you ever met a healthy woman.
What?
Several characters in the series saw service during the First World War. Most notably, Victor served with the American Expeditionary Forces in France during the war, but was somewhat traumatized by his experiences on return to America. Bobby Bastian served in the British Army and met his wife Elsa Arbogast while being treated for trench foot. Tracy Butler also mentions Atlas having served in the war. Other characters have most likely served in the conflict, but no other confirmations have been given at this point. Mordecai and Victor were once partners in crime under Atlas's supervision, taking care of robbers intruding on their territory in Defiance, Missouri, as well as whiling away the hours playing chess at the Defiance General Store. After Atlas died, Mordecai decided to quit Lackadaisy, reasoning with Victor to retire as well. According to Mitzi, though, that reasoning involved Victor getting kneecapped by Mordecai.
Regarding fan theories of the two being romantically involved, absolutely not. Victor finds the idea laughable, while Mordecai doesn't comprehend how it could even happen.
What?
What? What? I don't... What?
So, it's funny, is it? It's a joke. It's a joke. Okay, I get it. We're laughing now. Oh, lighthearted whimsy.
What is happening?
Throughout the comic, we see Rocky seems to have Mitzi up on a pedestal of sorts, always kowtowing to her every need and sticking by her no matter what. Some fans have speculated Rocky having a romantic interest in Mitzi, but more likely it is due to her helping take him in while he was living on the streets, giving him a job, clothes, and socialization, for which he likely now feels beholden to her. The last published Lackadaisy comic was Epithet in 2020. Around the time of its publication, a certain global pandemic began, as well as production on the Lackadaisy pilot. When we last left our heroes, Rocky and Freckle were on guard as Ivy began delivering a new liquor shipment to Lackadaisy. Mordecai and the Savoys, meanwhile, were busy interrogating a jewel thief with a hit on his head. Victor is laid up with his wounds, Zib is sent off to city jail, and Mitzi is hoping to get Lackadaisy cleaned up and running once again. What happens next? Wait and see.
Same bootlegging comic, same bootlegging website.
Regarding a continuation, though, Tracy has stated in forum posts before that Lackadaisy was planned as a four-volume run, eventually branching past 1927. But with the new animated series on the way, that plan might be on hold for a while, or locked up for quite a while longer. When the series premieres, we might just get more info on whether it will branch out from our first two volumes.
Victor wears an eye patch over his right eye and is very defensive against anyone trying to take the patch. According to Bobby in the comic Transgression, Victor lost his eye during a dockyard brawl after the Palmer Raids in 1920. While tossing strikebreakers left and right, a pry bar struck him in the skull, taking out his eye, as seen in his arrest record after the event. Atlas happened to witness the event and arranged a lawyer and lighter sentence for Victor, eventually bringing him onto the Lackadaisy operation to pay off the favor. Flowers and colors are an important theme in the comics, symbolizing certain characters. For example, Ivy is young and exuberant, represented by bright yellows and spring colors. Zib is laid back, represented by poppies and his red clothes. Mitzi is somewhat vain, accentuated by purples and clematis. Freckle is new to the whole rum-running operation, hence he wears green. And Mordecai's dark side and murderous tendencies are accentuated by his black suit with a striking red tie. Flowers even play a role in the names of the two rival drinking establishments. Lackadaisy. The Daisy. A symbol of innocence, loyalty, patient endurance. Marigold Room, the Marigold. A symbol of pain, jealousy, and cruelty. Before she married Atlas May, Mitzi was a young Mary Ellen Montgomery of Savannah, Georgia. Around 1914, a young Dorian Zabowski made her acquaintance and brought her into his band. Mitzi traveled with Zib and the band all over the country, during which time she and Zib grew closer. The two had a romantic relationship based on artwork. In 1920, though, things changed. During a performance at the Marigold Room, Zib and Mitzi crossed paths with Atlas May, who became smitten with Mitzi. The two married in 1921, though both Mitzi and Zib remained on good terms. After Atlas's death, though, Mitzi and Zib's friendship cooled. Zib had to think of his bandmates' well-being, questioning Mitzi's motives for keeping Lackadaisy running. Tracy Butler is one to admit that there are a few small anachronisms here and there throughout the comic, such as Victor's tabletop radio and early designs of Rocky's clothes looking more like a 1940s zoot suit than Jazz Age clothing. What's more, Wick supposedly owns a Duesenberg Model J, but the Model J was only made after the comic takes place in 1928. On the whole, though, things tend to smooth out as the comic goes along, and any straight-up anachronisms can be found in a few comic footnotes.
Nobody's perfect.
Hello,
darkness, my old friend.
Well, it's time for the next layer.
I guess I'm Avalar now. Fire and brimstone. Let's continue.
The Egan-Hogan Gang War was a 1921 to 1923 gang war that occurred in St. Louis after Max Greenberg defected to the Hogan Gang and supposedly put out a hit on the Egan's gang leader. Some portions of the gang war story seem to have made their way into the Lackadaisy storyline, such as the death of a gang leader with Atlas and the defecting member going to a rival faction with Mordecai. What's more, both Greenberg and Mordecai were Jewish men, both born in New York City, known for their brutal lifestyle.
Coincidence? I think not!
After being kicked out of the McMurray house at age 16, Rocky took up a string of unsuccessful jobs. First, he worked for his uncle's farm in Kankakee, Illinois. Afterwards, he rode the Missouri Pacific and had a job as a grill cook, catching fire only twice. Eventually, he joined a traveling circus as a roustabout, becoming an act himself through a Houdini-style escape routine. By 1923, the circus had failed, leaving Rocky unemployed and destitute once again. Come 1925, he caught the attention of Mitzi May and earned a job as a violinist with Zib's band in Lackadaisy. Adding to his job history, a February 25th Tumblr question revealed that Rocky also worked at a questionable mineral spring, but he lost his job once more after a typhoid outbreak.
Not bad then?
Better than getting shot.
Although a small facet of the series, religion does play a decent part in the comic series ahead, most notably with Nico and Seraphine being voodoo practitioners, hosting gatherings in their hotel room. Both siblings have reverence to the Loa and Maître Carrefour, after being led by them as children to the arms of Mama Eulalie. They even allow Mordecai into their little congregation.
What? Congregation? We, all of us. Except not that one. He invited himself. And what about that one? Is he alive? He doesn't blink.
He'll be fine.
Speaking for other characters, Aunt Nina is a devout Roman Catholic and raised both Rocky and Freckle in the Catholic faith. Sometimes too well. Mordecai himself comes from a Jewish background, although his habit of working on the Sabbath day likely means he is more secular than religious. And then there's Abelard Arbogast. In forum posts, Tracy revealed Abelard as a Lutheran pastor. These three groups, Catholics, Jews, and Lutherans, formed the major groups against nationwide prohibition.
Adding in my own two cents as Lutheran myself, Lutherans in general believe in salvation through God's grace, not by good works alone. And God's grace may only be received through belief in the promise of the Gospels, holy baptism, and communion. Good works, rather, are fruits of God's grace in the Holy Spirit. Good works such as moderation with alcohol. Luther himself was a fan of beer, but he viewed drunkenness as sinful, a sin caused by weakness. But a sin that was not detrimental to one's relationship with God. When the temperance movement caught on, many German Lutherans spoke out against the banning of alcohol as hypocrisy. Essentially, banning alcohol won't make this a more godly nation. And to their credit, they were kind of correct. You can see some of the Lutheran theology breaking through in Abelard's sermon to Ivy in the send-off comic.
Cheating at cards, hustling booze, preaching damnation, sure are a contradiction.
To you and your failure to understand anything. But of course, with the outlook of a child, you've confused temperance with temperance union blatherings. The idea that sectarian fine-tuning of the law represents rectitude. There's your contradiction. That the ravening
ambitions of industrial titans and the motives of a snooping, spying government add up to moral reform. That resigned prostration to the pantomime is upright. Self-sufficiency, independence of mind, action weighed with sober heart. These are the true and agonizing virtues at play. But then you arrive. And it's not just that you endanger everything functionally, but spiritually as well. Our greatest sin is illuminated. The contradiction. But the passing on of all this, like a cursed heirloom, to another generation that doesn't understand anything. What a pep talk, Bulaw! Bulaw!
After all, what would a German Lutheran be without a beer? A Swedish Methodist.
Forum posts by Tracy Butler reveal Rocky's parents to be Ransom and Sophie Rickaby. Sophie and Aunt Nina were sisters, coming to America together and being close as could be. But the two fell out after Sophie married Ransom. After Rocky was born, his mother spent a great deal of time in sanatoriums with tuberculosis. As Rocky put it, chasing the Red Death. Rance was a railroad employee who likely didn't care all that much about his son, so Rocky had to spend most of his younger days at Freckles' house, making it more of a home than his own home. It can be assumed his mother succumbed to TB, while his father likely abandoned him, based off a letter written to Freckle after Rocky was kicked out of the McMurray household. Dorian Zabowski started his band around 1914. The name of the band has never been fully agreed upon. Sometimes it's the Dixie Drifters Jazzing Orchestra, or the Down Basin Band, or the Down Basin Drifters Jazz Band. In the early days, the band played all over the Midwest, South, and Eastern Seaboard, with Zib playing saxophone, clarinet, and lead vocals, Cy on trumpet, JJ on trombone, Mozzie on piano, and Ben on the double bass. In Georgia, the band met a young Mary Ellen Montgomery. Changing her name to Mitzi, she joined the band on banjo and ukulele, plus lead vocals. During a gig in St. Louis around 1920, Zib's band crossed paths with Atlas May. Atlas fell for Mitzi, and the band found its home at the Lackadaisy. Mitzi left the band after marrying Atlas, but in 1925, a young drifter named Rocky Rickaby was brought in as the band's violinist, inheriting a blue suit from JJ, and the band coming to its current state as we see it today.
All right. Come on, kid. What do you say we go lighten the mood?
At its current status, the events of the Lackadaisy comic all happened within a four-day window in May of 1927 during Memorial Day weekend. The events of Rum Runner through Dithyram all happen on Thursday, May 26th. Reciprocity through Rendezvous occur on Friday, May 27th. Daybreak through Nightmare are all on Saturday, May 28th. And Nightmare through Epithet are all on Sunday, May 29th. In the comic Anodyne, we see a number of letters with Chicago postmarks addressed to Victor, one including a picture of his daughter. From these letters, we see that Victor was at one time married, and he has a daughter named Alena, roughly Ivy's age, attending school and living with her mother's family. This sheds more of a light on Victor's protective side towards Ivy. It can be seen that she is a surrogate for his own daughter that he cannot visit.
No, you have to go. It's dangerous here.
What's dangerous?
Sharp, heavy things. Tools.
As a teenager in New York, Mordecai took on small-time bookkeeping jobs for shady clients to support his struggling family. At one point during an extortion scheme, he killed a man who couldn't meet the quota. As time went on, Mordecai began embezzling from higher-ups, forcing him to go on the run and leaving his ill-gotten gains to his mother and sisters. While on a train outside Detroit with goons hot on his tail, Mordecai met Atlas, taking up a new line of work as Atlas's new hatchet man. A letter in correspondence shows the McMurray household's address to be 1116 North Benton Avenue, St. Charles, Missouri. This is a suburban section of the St. Louis Metro. Although Tracy has claimed in forum posts that the McMurray house is based off her own home. On the subject, Victor's house is located at 1367 North Market Street, St. Louis, Missouri, a small residential area not far from the North Riverfront. Over the years, Tracy has revealed a few characters to be LGBT, most notably a Tumblr post revealed that Seraphine had had some past experience with other women. Not surprising, since part of Seraphine's inspiration was the famed blues singer Gladys Bentley, who was openly lesbian early in her career. Regarding Zib, Tracy has hinted somewhat at him being bisexual, stating in one Tumblr post that he wouldn't really have any issue with romancing men.
How about you, Wick? Shall I serenade you personally?
Once I've had a few more illicit beverages, perhaps.
And then there's Mordecai. Definitely asexual. As asexual as a coral reef.
I don't... That's why... She... Can't you see I'm busy? Studying the botany.
The ficus?
It's an excellent ficus. I wish I were this ficus.
The characters in Lackadaisy all come from a variety of backgrounds. Rocky and Freckle are both Irish-American. Victor and his landlady, Mrs. Babka, are both Slovak. Nicodem and Seraphine are French Creole and likely mixed race. Mordecai's family are German Jews. It can be assumed that Ivy, the Arbogast, Lacey Hart, and Atlas may have at least some German blood in their veins as well, while Zib is of Polish descent, judging by his surname Zibowski. As for Dom Drago, Tracy has mentioned him coming from an Italian family.
Just like with the religious aspect, our gangsters represent backgrounds that were staunchly opposed to Prohibition, namely Irish, Jewish, and Central and Eastern Europeans.
While serving as Atlas's enforcement in Defiance, Victor spent a decent bit of time with the Arbogast family, in particular, Elsa. Both he and Elsa found a kindred spirit in each other, and were close enough that Victor was able to tell Elsa secrets of his past. Whether or not their relationship was romantic has never been stated, but they were still, at one time, very close. Throughout the comics, we see that Wick has no problem with sitting down for a drink, but also Irishing his coffee behind the secretary's back, sometimes pouring whiskey over his breakfast. He's able to drink Mitzi under the table, showing an increased tolerance to alcohol. Sometimes he is so impaired that his secretary Lacey Hart is the brains behind the outfit. Does this mean that Wick is an alcoholic?
No, wait, Lacey, wait. I wasn't yelling at you. I was yelling at the duck.
Leaving faster.
Well, modern definitions of alcoholism fall between dependence and abuse. From what Tracy has shared of Wick's past, we know he started drinking at a young age. He keeps a flask of whiskey on him at all times, and his drinking has already affected his, short-term memory. Based off this, I'd assume Wick suffers from alcohol dependence. But then again, I only play a doctor in 1826, and Wick is a fictional character. But he probably could benefit with a 12-step program. Anyhow, next layer. Now this is rather nice.
We see that Rocky is actually homeless in the comic. When Ivy inquires about Rocky's home in the comic Posterity, we see that he lives in the back seat of the Lackadaisy saloon car. Apparently no longer wanted in the McMurray house and not receiving pay for performing in Zib's band, this is his only place to call home. Carol McMurray was Reckle's father and Nina's husband. The two married out of pragmatism rather than love, but their marriage worked out. Carol was fairly meek, much like his son, but also exhibited some of his son's eccentricities. He passed away in 1921 in a fairly mundane circumstance, not long after which Rocky was kicked out of the McMurray household. One can assume that Carol was the peacemaker between Rocky and Nina before his passing. Mordecai was the son of Isaac Heller and Zipporah Weiss, two German-Jewish immigrants living in a tenement on Manhattan's Lower East Side. Isaac was debilitated by a stroke when Mordecai was 11, leaving Mordecai further attached to his sisters. His younger sister, Esther, eventually married but had no children. His younger sister, Rose, was very attached to Mordecai, making drawings for him despite protestations about her going through his pencil case. She also married and had one child. A third sister, Hannah, died in infancy, which Mordecai blamed on the family's squalid living conditions. Occasionally, Mordecai thinks back on his time with Rose, one of the few moments where he manages to crack just a little bit of a smile. In the sabbatical comic, we see Dom Drago's Daily Planner, with the phrase, "See Trumbull, Union Station, no show," under the heading for Saturday, May 28th. Who is C. Trumbull? Why didn't he show up?
I personally have a theory on this mysterious individual's identity, mostly through reading ahead in the comics.
We know that Drago is investigating Asa Sweet's Marigold for the Treasury Department, so Trumbull must have had some connections with Marigold. Reading Epithet, we learn that Gracie Grombach is a contact of Drago's, explaining the initials GG written under Tuesday, May 31st. In confessional, Mordecai offhandedly mentions that he had previously met Grombach's lawyer after the word hatchet, as it so happens. What does this all point to? Trumbull was the individual hatcheted up by Mordecai. The dates line up in the comic timeline. His disappearance coincides with a no-show on the 28th. It's pretty solid in my opinion.
Of course, this is only an opinion, not verified fact. Make of it what you will.
Ivy and Freckle are a cute couple, no doubt about it, but look closer at their relationship. It's mostly one-sided on Ivy's end. Freckle doesn't even know which way things are going. If anything, Ivy is only interested in Freckle just to spite Victor and live out her own silver screen-inspired fantasies. Will she actually develop true feelings for him? That remains to be seen. If not, then she better let the poor guy down easy, because we all know how he can get during times of emotional distress.
Sorry.
On the outside, Atlas and Mitzi seem to have a happy, devoted marriage. But Volume 3 sheds a little more light on their relationship. Mordecai mentions in confessional that by the time Atlas was murdered, he and Mitzi were going through a separation.
What could cause their relationship to deteriorate? Two theories.
One theory is that Atlas was somewhat of a womanizer. This would explain why so many people spread the rumor of Mitzi being his murderer. But this is in conflict with her increased devotion to Atlas's memory after his death.
Still, it's not the same without you.
The other theory? Mitzi and Zib. Evidence? The bathtub artwork. Zib is beat up in a bathtub while Mitzi tends to him, still wearing her wedding dress. Perhaps Atlas found out about their relationship, shut out Mitzi, was later murdered, and Mitzi was given the blame.
It's not the best explained theories, but let's just say it's likely that both Mitzi and Atlas had some previous baggage that was brought onto their marriage. Baggage that piled up to the point that Atlas bit the bullet.
The Babysitter comic explores what would happen if Mordecai were to look after an infant. Naturally, he tries every which way to get rid of the baby, finally dropping it in an open sewer to the open arms of the lovable tramp Virgil. The final frame of the comic reveals the baby became President Jimmy Carter. Obvious joke, but still.
He's history's greatest monster!
Although no official not-safe-for-work art exists of the Lackadaisy series, a quick search online will reveal a few fans who have made their own choice artwork of the series characters. When asked about this via Tumblr, Tracy is aware of these artists, but has no negative feelings towards their content.
But honestly, how bad could this NSFW really be?
Anyhow, that should take us to the very end of the iceberg chart. Oh, wait a minute. There's one more layer. What could it be? Cactus Friend was created by Rocky as a gift for Mitzi in the A Thing For You mini-comic. Understandably, she refuses the gift, and Cactus Friend continues to torment Rocky's every waking and sleeping moment.
But there's much more to Cactus Friend than is visible in his disturbing exterior.
Unlike many aspects of the mini-comics, Cactus Friend is actually canon to the main Lackadaisy storyline, as seen in the Posterity comic sitting in the back seat of the Lackadaisy saloon car.
What many people don't know is that Cactus Friend is sentient, and he has been influencing the comic from the very start.
Remember, Rocky lives in the saloon car. All his possessions are inside. Wherever the car goes, Cactus Friend follows. Who do you think tipped off the pig farmers? Who was it that caught the Arbogast's attention in defiance? That's right. Cactus Friend has been behind it all along. And let me check the photo from that was his murder. Aha! Definite proof!
So watch yourself, or else you too will face the wrath of Cactus Friend. But let's face it, that theory is as nutty as a fruitcake. A sentient cactus. Can you Adam and Eve it? Well, thank you to everyone for watching. I hope you enjoyed, and stay tuned for more fun videos from this channel. Until next time, I'm Captain Rutledge. Good day. Oh, there's someone at the door. Excuse me a moment.
That's funny. No one's here. Wait, what's this? Cactus? What? Oh no. Oh no!
Some had took to talking while the cats beat out a rhythm, and others picked on pecking cause the rhythm bug had bit them. They never had a lesson in their lives, but rhythm's what they're keeping. And when it comes to swinging that thing, it's as natural to them as sleeping or eating. There's a rumpus on the campus, they are really in the groove. Each and every paw has a natural urge to move. The thing they scorn is known as corn, they wish someone could stop it. The only use they found so far for corn is when you pop it.